Hello students, so last day we were doing the elements, the definition of elements and the properties of elements. So today what we do, since last day we already learned what are metals and non-metals, today we will learn some characteristics of metals and non-metals. This is something also that you have done in class 7, it's just a repetition. In fact, I would say you had rather done it in more details in class 7. So we'll just go very fast from here. These elements have metallic luster. Metals have metallic luster, that is shine, you are aware of it. Non-metals have no luster. Metalloids have properties of both non-metals and metals, so they might have luster, they might not have luster. Next, metals are mostly hard solids and non-metals can be soft solids, liquids or gases. Metals are malleable and ductile. So you know that malleable means it can be beaten into sheets and ductile means it can be drawn into wires, whereas non-metals are neither malleable nor ductile. Next, metals are very good conductors of heat and electricity and non-metals are bad, or there can be another word for bad, poor conductors of heat and electricity. And the last point, metals are sonorous, that is if you strike them with a heavy object, they produce a sound, whereas non-metals are actually not sonorous. So even if they are being beaten by a heavy object, they generally do not produce any sound. Examples, very important, you already know examples, so I'll not go into it. But what is also very important for you to know, which again you have done in class 7, but still I want to go into details of it, is the exceptions amongst metals and non-metals. Now when we talk of metalloids and noble gases, we don't talk of any exceptions. They are typical ones and they stay within each other. But metals and non-metals end up having a lot of exceptions. Now what are my exceptions? Let's look. What are my exceptions in metals? Sodium and potassium are soft metals. I said metals are hard solid, but these are soft. Mercury is a liquid metal. Zinc is brittle in nature. That is, if it falls from your hand, it will break down into pieces. And tungsten is a poor conductor of electricity. That means, students, in spite of being metals, these particular elements show characteristics very different from metals. I mean physical characteristics. Their chemical characteristics or the other characteristics remain the same, the way they react and all, but the physical characteristics differ. Now coming to non-metals, iodine and graphite are lustrous. So I just now said that metals are supposed to be not lustrous, but iodine and graphite are very much lustrous. Carbon fiber is ductile. Graphite is a good conductor of electricity and diamond is the hardest naturally occurring substance. Now we were just talking that, you know, non-metals are soft solids, but look at the hardest occurring substance, which is diamond, a form of carbon, and hence it is also a non-metal. Diamond being a form of carbon is also a non-metal. So these are some of my properties of metals and non-metals, and also the corresponding exceptions between metals and non-metals. Please remember that you have to at least learn minimum, I can say, 5 examples of metals, 5 examples of non-metals, like that. Don't think anything less than that. Now my next topic of discussion in this chapter will be compounds. We will talk about compounds. Now when we talk about compounds, obviously they are the second kind of pure substance after elements. So the second kind of pure substance after elements. Now let us see that what are the typical properties of compounds, or how are they formed. Now compounds, the first property I have written here is, two or more atoms or elements combine chemically to form a compound. Now these elements, atoms you can call, basically the correct word should be elements. Now these elements can be different elements, or it can be also the same element to form a compound. Second, they are pure and homogeneous. I have already explained the words in my previous video. Pure, obviously they have a fixed chemical composition, and homogeneous because they have that composition throughout. It's not that somewhere they have a fixed composition, somewhere they have a variable composition. No, not at all. Next, they have fixed melting points and boiling points. MP and BP stand for melting point and boiling point. Next, they can be separated by chemical methods. Now, in the previous one, elements cannot be separated. We had written they are nearly indivisible, and these compounds can only be separated by chemical methods. For example, chemical reactions, chemical changes. You cannot expect a simple physical change to break down a compound into its constituent elements. That is not possible. And the last one, during formation, energy is either absorbed or liberated. So any reaction, actually, when it happens, any chemical reaction, there is always a change of energy. And if this energy is absorbed, is taken up from the surroundings, we call it an endothermic reaction. You all are aware of it, students. We call it an endothermic, that is, it's taking up energy from the surroundings. And if energy is given out, we call it an exothermic reaction. We call it an exothermic reaction. Now, your worksheet for today will be, it's very simple. Since I've just started with a chapter, I cannot really give you long worksheets. So there are two questions that you have to solve for me. Two questions. Please write down the questions at the end of the video. First question will be, mention five differences between elements and compounds. Mention five differences between elements and compounds. And your second question will be, mention four examples of compounds. Mention four examples of compounds. So question number one, mention five differences between elements and compounds. And question number two, mention four examples of compounds. Thank you.